Jesus Gonzalez, and he's the co-founder of Bitergia. Did I say it right?
That's fine.
Yeah, okay. Well, I changed the name. The other one was... which is a software development analytics company specializing in analyzing of free and open source software projects. He also is a teacher and a researcher at the Universitat Rey Juan Carlos in Spain in the context of Libre Software Research Group. His interests include the study of communities of software development with a focus on quantitative and empirical studies. He enjoys taking photos of the coffee he drinks around the world. Welcome, Jesus.
Thank you very much. I'm using this one.
I'm always in this area.
Can you hear me? Okay, thank you. First of all, thanks for staying here. I'm going to talk a bit about the REST. That I'm obviously not a REST developer. I want to put some context into this before starting talking. A few years ago, we started to talk with the Mozilla Foundation about how to put analytics to track the different projects that Mozilla is having. We started to do that during the last autumn, and right now we're working with some people in the community team to basically try to monitor what's happening in the different communities around Mozilla. One of those is REST, and 2 months ago, it was decided that the REST dashboard goes public. The REST dashboard is exactly what I'm going to present here today, and it basically tracks what the people around REST is doing from certain points of view. So it's not only development, but it's mostly development. The idea is quite simple, is since most of the activity is public, let's track what's happening in that public activity data. And let's produce some information with it so that the people interested in the project can know what's happening and can react to what's happening. So that the community is, let's say, more self-aware of what's happening in it. Because when the project is large, usually just a few people know what's happening, but the rest maybe don't know. So there are several ideas, and in fact, this is work in progress. And I'm going to skip the first part, because it's just talking a bit about me and something else. That's not important. Let's go directly to the dashboard. So first of all, you can see the dashboard live if you want. You have the URL there. REST-analytics.mozilla.community. And it doesn't run really well on a phone, so try to do that with your laptop if you can, or with a tablet. And the idea is to show information from different data sources. In this case, on the top we have Git, then we have a StackOverflow. This is a part of tracking what the community is doing around REST. Then we have GitHub issues, GitHub pull requests, and there's some more information from this course as well. Each of the information there corresponds to one data source if you look by rows. If you look by columns, on the first one you have some simple metrics summarizing. On the next, you have some metrics summarizing activity, like number of commits or number of pull requests or stuff like that. And on the other one, you have people. So you have a number of people authoring commits, a number of people submitting issues, or stuff like that. Here you have a very rough try to have affiliation for people. It's not really also any bad report. I will be telling you later how you can submit it, because many people are probably not well affiliated yet. But the idea is to show how many people are working for Mozilla, how many people are working for their companies, and how many people are working as independents in the community. And you can filter by time. If you go there on the top right, there is time. By default, it's like 2 years, I guess. But you can focus on the latest activity, like the 3 months. And you can select any period of time and so on. Everything is actionable, so you can pick almost everything. You can resize things, you can move a chart and stuff like that. And you can search. If you go again after doing any kind of filtering or something, you can go to the top right and search. And I'm going to go to the real thing. My connection is a bit messy, so I'm not sure if I'm going to be able to do this well. But, well, and the other is... Okay, sort of. Let's see a bit about Git. So you have that menu on the top where you have the different data sources. And for each data source, you have a panel, and in some cases, you have more than one. As I said, everything is actionable, so you can click and filter. So for instance, this is a total activity for REST. And by the way, you can notice how this chart is different from the one in the main page. That's because of bots. if you remove the filter bots, you can see how the activity during the last time is a bit higher. And I also have to say that this is tracking the activity in the real repository, which means that those commits that didn't make it to the repository yet are not there, but maybe they are having a date from the, let's say, the past, because we are tracking alpha time. So that means that if the commit was done, like, I don't know, 1 month ago, and maybe it's going to land in the repository next month, it's still not there. So that's why this trend at the end of the chart is, useful. In any case, you can track, as I said, people by company. For instance, if you are interested in who of those are working for Mozilla, you can just add the filter, and now you are seeing activity by people by Mozilla, as I said, assuming that the data we have is correct. You may notice those filters over there, the red and green boxes. You can click on them, and if you look, I'm not going to enter into the details, but you can see how you can activate them, negate them, and stuff like that. So that, for instance, you can see how the people not working for Mozilla are performing in the different data sources. You can as well go down and see more information like the number, the name of the people and their contributions, the organization, number of organizations over time, and you can also go and check the different repositories that you have. And you can, for instance, filter for one of those. So I'm going to filter in the RAS repository, and this is now the main activity for the RAS repository. By the way, this is the time zones of the people working in this repository. So basically, this is California and the East Coast, and the West Coast in the States. This is the East Coast and South America. This is Europe and Africa. This is Asia, and this is Australia and surroundings. The most interesting information from my point of view is from the GitHub staff, where you have how you're performing and doing things like giving bug reports and stuff like that. We don't have a separate analysis for the different kinds of issues yet, but for now you can see how the number of issues are coming over time, and the different colors are related to whether they are still open or already closed. So you can very easily come here and see, in this case, let's say closed is the pink one, so that screen is windows pink. So you can see the number of banks that you still have closed from the past, and you can see how many people are submitting banks over time. Again, you can click on many things like filtering by repository and stuff like that, and maybe most important, you can come here and see who is submitting bags issues by affiliation, by the company. You can again look at the number of the names of the people doing that. If you're interested in performance, how are you really dealing with closing tickets? Some metrics are very important, like how long does it take to close 50% of the tickets, for instance. And you can see that in the issues timing. Here we have, again, all the repositories, but on the bottom part, you start to have some information about how long does it take to close the tickets submitted by these persons, for instance. These are days. So you can see for some of them it's 100 and something days, for some of them are 20 days, and so on. And probably the most interesting one, of course, you can also go directly to the tickets. Those are the latest, and those are the earliest. So for instance, this ticket here has been sitting in the repository for about 1700 days, like a couple of years. And you can look at them, and it's also an easy way of going there and see why this ticket is still open. So maybe there's a reason for that ticket to be open, or maybe you can somehow assign it to somebody and close it or something. And on the right, you look, you can see some charts related to, as I said, the median time in the closing bags. So this is how long does it take to close 50% of the bags. And the row axis is in days, so you can see that you have spikes of around 150 days, but right now it's much closer. That's the day when that's the month when the bug was reported or when the issue was opened. So that means that for older tickets, the time is smaller than for certain periods in the history. This is the same for 80%. and an 80% loss at gradient. That means that a ticket cannot be be sitting in the repository for longer than the time since it was opened. So that means for 80% of the tickets, most of them, the remaining 20% are still there. So for all the months, you have probably more than 20% of the tickets are still open. That's why you have this sharp line over there. And again, you have some mirrors and issues open and close. And you can, by the way, filter maybe, for instance, only for open tickets, which is usually the most interesting view because close is closed. But you can see the same data for those tickets that are still alive. And you can see well, that how in that case you are still separating to in the creation in the live tickets. You can see the same for pull requests. I'm not going to enter into details, just to show you the general information, which is quite similar to tickets. But when you're talking about pull requests, you can also see the timings. And the timings is basically the time from the moment somebody submits a batch to the moment somebody gets information, gets the patch landed in Git. So that's a very interesting metric when you are trying to attract developers, because if they are submitting data, submitting code, and the code is taking too long to be accepted, usually they give up. This is the backlog. The backlog is basically the stuff that still needs to be done, so the things that are alive, from the point of view of issues and from the point of view of pull requests. So again, you can see some numbers, like how many times you are dealing with this, and this is the structure by time of, in this case, issues. So these are issues still open by time. So this is, for instance, 2015. So for the whole last 2 years history, there were a certain number, around 30 to 50 issues open. The history of pull requests is very different. So this is the backlog, and here you can see the comparison, because in pink you have issues, and in green you have pull requests. And you can see now for pull requests, most of them are already closed. So you only have some green spots in some parts. You can filter that and see exactly the structure of the pull requests. And you can see how it is much better than for issues. So that means that you have some pull requests which are very recent. Most of them around this time are closed. And you have some of them that are still ancient, like 2 years old. But just a little of them. So the structure of how people are closing pull requests or dealing with pull requests and dealing with issues is very different in this case. And another interesting view is, as I said, the StackOverflow, because the StackOverflow talks about the outreach of the project. So how many people are asking about this project? It's a very good indicator in general of how many people are interested in this project from a development point of view. And the trend here is also, I would say, interesting. If you look only at questions, which is just by filtering here, you can notice how well the tension was going up during the 2015 at the beginning, went down, and in the beginning of 2016, and then it's going up again, maybe a bit slower, but more consistently. So this trend is basically, very likely correlated to the interest of the developer community in the language. At least from the point of view of when they are willing to make questions and so on. Of course, with time, there are more questions answered, so you have also to discount that. So in many cases, you have not questions because people already have the answers in StackOverflow. And with respect to discourse, well, you can see basically the structure of how discussions are happening. Since the discourse forums were started to be used not that long ago, you have this very quick trending. Uptrend. Still, it's difficult to know whether this is really a trend or this is just because people are starting to use the forums now. You have, of course, again, the specific threads and who is talking in those threads and all of that. And with respect to the dashboard, I guess this is also, I'm going to skip a bunch of slides, which basically we're dealing with all of this. And very briefly, I'm going to talk about the software doing this. All of this is, of course, free software. And the architecture is quite simple and gives a lot of opportunities for developers to come and script and get data. We basically go to repositories with a tool called Parseval, get all the information from it, and store it in Elasticsearch. Then we use Bloomberg basically to produce the Kibana indexes, because the code that we're using for the dashboard is Kibana. And well, we visualize everything with Kibana. Those indexes that Kibana uses can be also queried with a language, with Python, for instance. And that means that it's very simple to get scripts to do specific things on the data and get out interesting metrics that maybe you are interested in, or things like my activity in the repository over time, or which are my layers contributions or whatever. So there is a manual for using Grimoire Lab, and the people living with this in Mozilla, which is basically Henry, is very interested in finding some people who could be interested in looking at metrics and providing any kind of input, or trying to learn how to extract information from the database and so on. It's very easy. So for instance, these are the tools. This is the tools, these are the backend supported, and this is a very simple Python code, which is giving the activity number of commits, removing merge commits from a certain date by quarter. So you can see that it's not rocket science. It just gave him a couple of queries, and this is a standard Elasticsearch, so there's nothing specific for our tools. The main lesson here is that there's a lot of data in the database with what the REST developers doing. If you're interested in getting any kind of idea about what's happening, or try to find reasons for things, it's very easy to go there and look for the data. And this may have usually, or may lead hopefully, to more interesting discussions, because you can discuss on data and not on opinions. And just to finish, you can also check Kaolin if you want, which is basically the same stack, but for analyzing any GitHub organization. So if you want, just submit your organization there, it's free, and you get a free dashboard with all the organization, more simple than the one for REST, but usually interesting enough for giving it a try. So it's just Kaolin.io. And enjoy. The idea is go visit there. If you have any kind of comment, bug report, suggestion, whatever, we're happy to get it in the participation metrics or repository for GitHub, for Mozilla. And if you want to learn more about Gimor Lab, you have gimorlab.github.io, where you have also an entry to a nice training manual where you can learn about the thing. And that's it from my point of view. So any question or comment or anything? Do you need the mic or? Okay, please.
Can you say a bit more about how you do the
associations with organizations? Yeah. Basically, we do it, the question is about how we link our persons to organizations, right? We do it in two steps. First of all, we try to find all the identities for the same person, which basically means trying to match email addresses and all identifiers, GitHub identifiers, and stuff like that. And then we try to affiliate them. For affiliating them, we have like some heuristics, like using the email email address. If you have a Mozilla email address, probably you're working for Mozilla, for instance. And then we can do it manually too. There's a file where basically you find you try to define for every person the different periods of affiliation for them. This file is going to be shared with the community so that the community can also update it, but that's not